The title of this lecture is Their Life on Marx. The subtitle refers to the fact that, as you know, Marx published the first book of Capital in the first edition in 1867, so 150 years ago. So the subtitle is Das Kapital after 150 years. What I will provide in this lecture for sure will be two things. I have a first part which is a kind of methodological introduction to the reading of Capital as a whole, the three books. But in my lecture, I will focus especially on volume one. I will touch, however, some points about the second volume and the third volume. In particular, these references to the second and third volume will be more substantial about Marx's Crisis Theory. My discourse begins with the attempt to understand what is the meaning of the subtitle of Das Kapital. The subtitle is a critique of political economy. So we have to understand what political economy means and what critique here means. As you know, Marx distinguished vulgar economics or vulgar political economy on one side and political economy on the other side. Vulgar economics, and this is true of much of economics today, stops at the superficial appearances. These appearances are, in fact, illusory semblances. In the Marxian vocabulary, they are instances of shy semblances. And they focus on circulation without connecting circulation to production. Political economy, classical political economy, is another thing altogether. For Marx, it is truly a science of capital. It began, according to Marx, with William Petty. Then it has a long story, which has to do with the labor theory of value. The main exponents were François Quesnay and the physiocrats, Adam Smith, but especially David Ricardo. It was a science, essentially. It was bourgeois, but it really accomplished something. Ricardo especially linked value the labor embodied in commodities, and he did that in a way that was attempting to construct a coherent value theory as price theory, even though, according to Marx, this attempt was failed. So the point is, vulgar economics stops at the semblances, at the superficial appearances in circulation. Political economy gives an analysis of the inner reality of capital and of production. It is, however, unfinished and limited. Hence, there is a need, according to Marx, of a critical political economy. We are not yet at the level of the critique of political economy, but the scientific discourse of political economy had to be developed by Marx himself so that a critique could be provided. Political economy, also critical political economy, deals with the question how capital produces. The question which is more basic, and is more basic also for the critique of or to political economy, is how capital is produced. So not starting with capital as already given, but something to be constructed. And in my view, the first volume of capital is exactly that. I stop to these simple elements about the political economy. We could say that the political economy, up to a point, classical political economy goes beyond the level of semblance, of shine, and comes near, probably never reaching it properly, the dimension of dealing with the phenomenical manifestation. But this is something that, as I said a second ago, classical political economy really is not able to do. It goes from the superficial to the inner reality, but it is not able to link the two. Critique to political economy wants to link the two. Wants to link the moment of shine with what Marx calls the moment of Erscheinung, the phenomenal manifestation, within a proper scientific, then dialectic, thus exposition of the world. Probably being here in a philosophical department and in the presence of the Honorable Janusz, you see Hegel
as the sun.
There, on the horizon. But for the moment, let us look at the Kantian moment. In a sense, the word critique, in the critique to political economy, can be referred to Kant. Here, critique may mean the inquiry about the conditions of possibility of political economy. It is not Kantian because this is not transcendental, meaning something abstract and general. These conditions of possibility have a concrete historical dimension. They have to do, according to Marx, with market, exchange, and money. Those who were there yesterday may recognize that this is the point on which Adorno and the Neue Marx Lecture were working on. The second point about the notion of critique, which must be stressed from the beginning, is that the critique of political economy is not just a development of science, as it was inherited by Marx. So the same critical political economy is not enough. I am not All the authors, they were when I was young, they are there now, who put a break between critique of political economy and critical political economy. I think that the two things should be pursued together. But for sure, the critique of political economy, that is not exhausted in a development of science. It is something very strange. It is the fact that you are developing science and at the same time you are criticizing science itself. So Marx is really opening a new theoretical continent from this point of view. He is not breaking all together the classical political economy of Ricardo. The continuity is important, but the discontinuity is also important, and is even more important. You cannot understand continuity if not looking at it from the discontinuity. Third alert, critique is not criticism. I think that in German there are two words, in English there are two words, in Italian unfortunately not, we have only critica. To be very quick, for criticism I mean the pointing out of errors in some opponent's theory, category mistakes, contradictions. Most of the Marxists, both economists and philosophers, understand the critique of political economy in this way. It is wrong. Critique, instead of criticism, recognizes the inner truth of what is criticized. So, of classical political economy and political economy more generally. Actually, if you read Marx's writings, you even see that even though it was very hard with vulgar political economists, he took them seriously too. So there are examples are Malthus, examples are Samuel Bailey and others. After these three first points, let me move to some more substantial, and it is why the need to present a critique of political economy. Marx's reasons may be expressed in this way. Marx's political economy didn't have the idea of the duality of labor, concrete labor and abstract labor, behind use value and action value, and must then move from action value to action. Second, and related to this, classical political economy, including Ricardo, had an idea of the substance of value, of the magnitude of value, but couldn't develop a theory of the form of value. So, the first reason is classical political economy and Ricardo didn't have a proper notion of labor. Now we see that they didn't have a proper vision of money, actually. The third point, which in a sense may be seen as the, one of the key points of Marx, is that classical political economy, maybe they hinted, but never reached the distinction between labor power and living labor. This is in the ABC of any discourse on Marx. What is not in the ABC is that for Marx, these two dimensions, labor power and living labor, are attached to human beings as living bearers of labor power. And this we will see as a crucial importance for Marx. The fourth thing that classical political economy does not have is an adequate theory of crisis. In a sense, they either have the idea that capitalism is not experiencing real profound crisis. This is the perspective not only of Ricardo but also of Jean-Baptiste. Or Malthus and Sismondi, they have the idea that the crisis is so deep that actually capitalism itself is impossible. So you never have crisis in capitalism. If this is the critique of political economy, the critique of political economy is, I repeat what I already said, a critique of bourgeois science of capital, of the science of capital. In a sense, the science of capital cannot but be bourgeois up to a point. But, this thing I want to add now, it is not directly a critique of capital itself. Marx has the idea that you can only deal, so to speak, with theoretical objects, objects of knowledge, behind which there are the real objects. At the same time, this theoretical and logical critique of political economy gives the instruments to understand capital as it is and to attack capital as a real object. I cannot go into the detail here, but this is related to a point that I treated in my lecture yesterday very quickly, referring to Max Horkheimer and Alfred Schmidt. Marx is neither a traditional materialist nor an idealist. His approach is that of a practical materialist, and here the term is referring to the thesis on Feuerbach and especially the second thesis on Feuerbach. So the point raised by Horkheimer and Schmidt is that the exposition of Stellung, critical, the stellung is possible only from the perspective of an emancipatory transformation of reality. I told you in an aside that Marx's exposition, the stellung, is dialectical. This dialectical method includes an analytical forschung, an analytical inquiry, which must arrive to the point that the whole can be exhibited as a structural system. This point is in Hegel, but in a different form. Is also in Althusser. The specific point of Marx, which I think is more in Hegel than in Althusser, is that the object capital, which is expounded through this critique of political economy is a fetish. As I told you yesterday, for Marx, capital as a fetish is also a subject, and the theme, the things in which capital materializes really have social powers. These real social powers that are proper of things in the capitalist situation are mystified as natural properties of the things itself. And this is not the fetish character, but the fetishism, the naturalization of the human relation. So Marx says at the beginning of Capital, relations between among people present themselves, appears is a machine, present themselves as they are. It is not a semblance. That is, as relation among things. But the point of Marx in understanding why capital, not only how capital, but why capital, is that this non-human reality must be reconducted to some human practice behind it. The human practice which constitutes the fetish. And we will see that we will find this in the first book of Capital. We will see that the book of Capital actually begins with Capital as a fetish, as a finished form, but then moves from here to understand capital as a relation, as capital as a social relation, which has at its core class struggle, and more specifically class struggle in production. This dialectical method, this is a third reference that I have to do to the lecture of yesterday, is a method which is not universal. It can be properly applied only to capital. There is no diamant in Marx, no dialectical material, but there is not even a Nagel's idea of depositing or the presupposition as a universal method to be applied to some whole. No, it is the method to study this very strange and paradoxical object, which is capital. So this method will disappear as long as capital will disappear. It is what is called method of withdrawal, method on recall. Reichel calls it Methode auf Widerruf, if my German is right. Let us begin to read Marx. But to read Marx, unfortunately, we have a few more alerts. Because now we move from the meaning of critique to the meaning of reading. There is the possibility of a mere reading of Marx. My lecture here, as the 14 lectures in Italian that you find on YouTube, are meant to help people to open the book and read it. A mere reading reveals, in my view, a lot of incoherence and ambivalences in Marx. A second, more sophisticated stage is what I call the stage of interpretation. Following the best line of Marx, this is, of course, something that one has to construct theoretically, can this ambivalences, incoherences be overcome, be resolved? A as you will see, my personal conclusion that even the best reading of Marx, even the more proper interpretation of Marx, is not able to dissolve completely the difficulties of Marx. So I think a third movement must be done. And it is the movement of Reconstruction. My talk today will be mostly at the level of interpretation. I will give a hint to what Reconstruction means. Reconstruction means, I use the expression of Backhaus, going with Marx against Marx, trying to solve the difficulties in Marx, going against Marx. Against Marx means using those richness which are there in his value theory and that he didn't exploit it, but it also means asking ourselves, is there a new political economy after Ricardo which can illuminate us? My idea is that yes, it's there, and it is especially the monetary macroeconomics of the 20th century. So my reading is not Marxist, but Marxian. It's not Marxian, the distinction is due to Maximilien Ruben. The way I use this distinction is the following. We cannot even just propose what Marx said. So Marxian does not mean Marx versus the Marx. Means that we have to do what Marx himself would do today. Marx would revolutionize his categories. You see, he published only the first book of Capital himself. He never left it calm, so to speak. He changed the first three chapters, he included other stuff. He was never satisfied. The second thing is that, as I said, we have to understand what is the new political economy and provide a criticism of political economy. Like with Ricardo, learn from the monetary macroeconomics of the 20th century, but providing a critique. The third thing is to understand the changes in capitalism. When Marx was asked by a journalist in the 80s of the 19th century, why you don't publish this second book, Volume of Capital, he said there is a huge crisis in England. It involves finance and banking. I cannot write anything until this thing ends and I understand how the institutions are changing, and so the categories must follow this. I am in agreement with Karl Korsch when Karl Korsch says that Marx theory must be historicized, must be read from now backwards. I will not go into the details, you will see that what I am doing is reading Marx from the point of view of the historical moment in which I learned Marx. It was during in the 60s and early 70s, the Turing of the class struggle at Fiat, and it is the present situation of is called Great Recession. I go and ask questions to Marx. This may seem to some of you strange, but it is really Marxian. It is what Marx did when he wrote the theory of surplus value. You don't go to the theory of surplus value to understand what really Adam Smith said, what really David Ricardo said. He was questioning the past authors from a theoretical question of his own. The paradox is that going in this way, what I'm able to give you, again I am paraphrasing Hans-Georg Backhaus, are fragments of a systematic reason. I think that the reasoning must be systematic, but I can give you only fragments, as Backhaus did. My division with most of the Hegelian readers, my friends, many of them are my friends, is that they want to give you the system anew. And each one of them, in each book, is criticizing himself or herself, changing the past translation of Marx into Hegel. I think we are forced to stay into this fragment stage. Now let us really begin in the next 30 minutes or the first part. Let us begin reading Capital. For those who were here yesterday, for obvious reasons, there will be an overlapping. But I hope to be clear for everybody. Marx begins with commodity. Commodity is structured on an inner duality, an internal duality. Use value and exchange value. When we look at exchange value seems just the quantitative ratios in which use values are exchanged on the market. And this is exactly what vulgar economics sees. But Marx says no, we are behind this first definition of exchange value, because there will be another one, we detect value, a property of universal exchangeability. He linked use value and value to the concrete labor producing use value, and the abstract labor producing the value. Some friends of mine, Chris Arthur, question marks on this. He thinks that Marx puts in labor too early in the system. I understand this reason, but I am a poor economist. I can give you only a fragment of the reasoning. I prefer here to follow in Marx's footsteps. Marx is just arguing that most of the commodities are produced by labor, and at the first stage I simplify and do not consider the commodities which are not produced by labor. So, at first, the universal exchange of commodities is universal exchange of products of labor to be exchanged on the market. And from there, it comes use, value, and value. Is there an intrinsic value or an absolute value in the commodities? Marx says, third page, it seems it is not there. It seems. It's a sentence. Marx is saying, in some meaningful way, the notion of intrinsic value and absolute value in a commodity is meaningful. But it's not clear now to understand why it is meaningful. Because I take whatever commodity, I can even feel and touch use value, but what about value? Value can't be handled anywhere. So, up to now, value is just a ghost. Marx is saying that value is just a ghost. Strictly speaking, at this point of exposition, underlined, value does not exist. To exist, the ghost must take possession of a body. Lui ha detto, where are we? In a ghost story? Yes, we are in a ghost story. There are wonderful essays by the Italian literary theorist Franco Moretti on this and more. And this theme will come again and again. I don't think that these are metaphors. These are scientific categories appropriated to what Marx is saying. Does it value take possession of a body? In Marx's first chapters, yes. Already in the first chapter, actually speaking. The ghost take possession of a body through the embodiment of value in money as a commodity, in money as gold. This embodiment in German is verkörpern, taking possession of a body. Marx is moving from value as substance, which is actually discussed in paragraph 1 and 2 of chapter 1, to value as form, paragraph 3. If you stop at 1 and 2, as many Marxists do, paragraph 1 and 2, you are quite excused in thinking that value is just labor contained or even embodied. I don't annoy you why I think that the translation of abstract labor as labor embodied is wrong. But just for to be put out there. You can be excused to think, if you stop there, that the labor which is the substance of commodities is physiological labor. When you move to paragraph 3, you are moving to the form of value, so the derivation of the equivalent, single, total, and then universal, and you are in a completely different world, not physiological labor all together. In fact, value is this ghost which is exhibited in the use value of gold as a commodity. The abstract labor of the commodities, what is it? It is the not immediately social labor, the immediately private labor, which has to become social on the market. And when it becomes social on the market, the market, when it is exchanged with gold as a use value, that is, with the concrete labor producing gold as universal. If you go and read Marx, you say that it plays on these dialectical concepts very, very much. Concrete labor producing the money as a commodity is the only immediately social labor. At this point, Marx is saying that commodity exchange, Warenaustausch, is immediately monetary. He is saying something that is completely new for any theory before and after, that universal exchange of commodities is immediately monetary and that this money is exhibiting value. You have a lot of non-monetary or pre-monetary value theories. You have some monetary theory, but in general, those who stress money does not have value. And those who stress value think that money is a veil or something covering it. So abstract labor and value until now are categories which realized, comes fully into being, only in the final circulation, in what Marx calls an exposed socialization, Vergesellschaftung, of these abstract labels, the theme of yesterday. We have succeeded in a miracle. I use the term miracle not by chance. The ghost has taken possession of the body. This embodiment, related to the verb verkörpern, Marx says is also an incarnation, incarnation. If you wish, but this is what Marx says, value is the Holy Ghost, use value is the human being, and money is both, that is Jesus. There is a famous quote from chapter 4 in which this is out there. Especially in chapter 3, Marx is showing that this taking possession of a body, this gothic story, corresponds also to the construction of money as money. Money as money is money as a chrysalis, the embodiment of abstract wealth to be taken aside by the possessor. What is the name for the desirizer? The miser. The miser would like to have more wealth, accumulating this gold, but this is something which destroys itself. It can have more money, only not consuming. But that, in a sense, is money as money, and Marx shows that money must stay in this state. What is this state? Marx moves from a narrator of a ghost story to an entomologist. He says, this is a chrysalis. Money is money, however, must, like the chrysalis, becomes a butterfly. The miser must become the capitalist, which from a given money produces more money. I stop here with the interpretation or the reading, and just add a thing on which I was much detailed yesterday. I have to go quick here now. I just say here that Marx, in these three chapters and already in the first chapter, is presenting two arguments which may seem contradictory. The first is abstract labor and value exist in the unity of production and circulation, but in fact, in the moment of exchange of commodities. The second argument is yes, but this abstract value and abstract labor and the value which are materialized in final circulation express a movement of expression. Expression ausdrucken, from the inner to the outer, from something which is already commensurable, somehow already social, before final exchange. When I go from this apparent contradiction to the interpretation, I say, no, this is not a contradiction. These two things may stay together if you read these chapters, taking into account that Marx is assuming that money is a commodity. And in my interpretation, this has not much to do with the monetary system he had in front of him. Money has to be a commodity because it is the external incarnation of the real universal in the body of God. If this is granted, when commodities are produced before exchange, they have a price tag, a money name. This money name already homogenizes commodities, but this money name is based on a given value of money. And Marx says this given value of money, in a money as a commodity system, is fixed at the point of production of gold as a commodity, when gold is sold against all the other commodities. This, Marx says, is barter, but gives you the exchange ratios that permits the price tag before final exchange to be also a quantitative determination of value. You can go and read with ease and see if something of what I'm saying is there. I think it's there because Marx defines this exchange as an original barter, exchange of products, not exchange of commodities. What is sure from my point of view is that, yes, the interpretation shows that Marx is not contradictory, but for me it is very strange. The great thing Marx did, a monetary value theory, or monetary labor theory of value, which is at the same time based on barter. This could be lower than the first three chapters. And why? Because in the first three chapters, commodities are not already produced. So, okay. But when we go into the fourth, fifth, sixth chapter, Marx is talking of the production of commodities. Commodities has to be produced. And in a monetary economy, the production of commodities, the production of what will be the commodities, has to be monetarily financed. There must be a monetary anticipation. So, if gold is money as a commodity in a capitalist setting, gold must be produced, the production of gold must be financed. By what? By gold, and you go back, and you go back, and you go back. This is a vicious circle. Let us leave aside the first three chapters, and let us move to the fourth chapter, more precisely, the chapters, now I'm going to chapters from 4 to 7. As I told you yesterday, here we have a problem when I refer to the chapters. Because the Italian translation is based on the 4th German edition. The English translations are based on the 3rd German edition adapted to the 4th. The numbering of the chapters is different from the 4th on. So in the 4th German edition, chapters 4, 5, 6 are on chapter 4. And chapter 7 is chapter 5. Conventionally, I use the English numbers. Chapters 4, 5, 6. The problem Marx is asking is how the chrysalis turns into a butterfly. How we move from money as money to money as capital. Money as money, this is literal, it is Marx, is value embodied. In Marx, you never have abstract labor embodied. But you have that gold is a verb the hotel. And what I said before should explain why Marx is saying this. Money as capital is money begetting money. Money begetting more money. How this is possible? Marx, especially the wonderful first page of chapter 4, is talking of capital as this gigantic fetish, which is also a gigantic subject or subject. I know that when there is a translation in German, denounced in capital blocks, so subject is written with the non-capital S. In this case, the capital block is right. Marx is talking of capital as a subject in the same sense that Hegel's Geist is a subject. Marx uses the adjective übergreifend. It is an overgrasping and dominating subject. Overgrasping in the new translation proposed by the translators of the Encyclopedia Logic in English. No? It is the subject which encompasses within itself all the moments. But it also does violence to this moment. It is, there is a moment of domination. And Marx is saying value as capital is money as capital. Capital is circulating value, so capital is neither value nor money in themselves. It is them changing from one form into the other. This subject, says Marx, is positing its own presupposition. It's like God. And there is exactly the reference to God in that quote, if you go there, and the reference to Jesus and the Holy Ghost, etc. In this new reality, the aim is not anymore use value, so it is not anymore wealth, it is not anymore rectum, concrete wealth, it is wealth. So, if you wish, absolute. Opposite of wealth. In fact, it is valorization. Wert, I think the German is Verwertung, but I'm not going to say
Verwertung.
Now, my point is that in chapter 5 or 6, Marx is asking, but how this strange butterfly came into life? How this is possible? And he presents all the arguments, which are the apologetic arguments of Fuller economy, why the value anticipated as money need to receive profits, dismantles them all together, and in chapter 6 says capital was lucky enough to find a very special commodity. Labor power, living labor, uniting in the human beings, which are the bearers of labor power. I will come back on this specificity in a moment. Because I want to go immediately to chapter 7. My interpretation of Marx is very much focused on the second section. Chapters. In the first section, you have the discourse of Marx on the labor process. And there are a lot of interesting things also for my discourse. But in the second section, the point is the valorization process. The answer of Marx to what political economy couldn't understand, explain. I read the genetical arguments of Marx about the origin of surplus value not as a dialectical deduction. Here there is a break in my view with Engel, but as a specific reference to a constitutive process, constitution. When I was young, those who were there and those who may read those documents knew that this debate on constitution was very much at the heart of the age, but also at the heart of the German student movement and theoretician. I refer this constitution not only to the human practice behind the universal exchange, but the human practice behind what is happening in the capitalist labor processes. I read the second section, chapter 7, according to what I call Marx's use of the method of comparison. Marx compares two situations. One seems to be hypothetical, but it says something very important on the real capitalist situation. The other situation is the movement from the first situation. It is what is called sometimes in philosophical science a counterfactual argument, an hypothetical reason. I am not the first to use the term method of comparison. If you go and read Isaac H. Rubin up to the end of the book, because I realize that most people that have read Rubin stop in the middle, you realize that when he speaks about the transformation problem, he attributes to Marx a method of comparison, so I borrow the term from him. And in fact, Rubin knew very well that chapter in that situation was already analyzed by an Italian idealist philosopher, Benedetto Croce, according to a counterfactual hypothetical reason. My method of comparison is different both from Benedetto Croce and from Rubin himself. Benedetto Croce said, what is the comparison of Marx? Let us first imagine a society of pure workers without capital. So there is no exploitation, no surplus value. Then let us imagine an input of a sociological element, so that now we have a deduction from the wage, which is the all income in the society. And that is the capitalist situation. So, non-capitalist economy, capitalist economy. Neoclassical economics, say Croce, is okay for the non-capitalist economy. The novelty of Marx is the sociological analysis of the origin of surplus value from this deduction of the wage. The method of comparison of Rubin is different, but not enough. He says, well, from the first chapter, we know that there is a social relation in capitalism, which is the relation in exchange of the capitalist producers. We don't know yet what they are. I said capitalism. In universal exchange, Rubin says, there is a social relation among the producers of commodities. We do not yet know that they are capitalist producers. So they exchange according to what? To some ratios of exchange, and profit cannot be already there because we have not deduced profit. You are in the same situation as Croce. This is not a universal generic economy, it is a universal exchange economy, but still you have the economy that we have in front of us as universal exchange with an income, and this income is going entirely to the workers. Then there is a deduction from the wage of the workers. Scorpius, and there is the origin of prophets, which is of course different to the capitals of each sector. Rubin says, in this situation, gross profits emerged. If I take into account of the different conditions of production, the prices should not be the prices proportional to the labor contained in commodities. Should be the capitalist prices embodying a normal average equal rate of profit. But Marx sticks to the simple prices, which are proportional to the labor contained in commodities, what in the literature since the 60s are called simple prices or direct prices. I can give you the name of the authors. Stick to them. Why? Because you first want to analyze the origin of surplus value as a whole. Only later see how the capitalist pricing goes together with the splitting of the surplus value in different fractions. I object also with Rubin's method of comparison. Because in my view, if one reads Marx, Marx's method of comparison is different. It does not start from an economy which is there with inputs and outputs evaluated in value of money terms, and it is unchanging. No, he says the capitalist in spe, the capitalist who advances money and hope to get more money, buys labor power, pays a wage, we know variable capital, pays the means of production, constant capital, extract from the workers the necessary labor, which is equal to the labor contained in their wages, this capitalist extracts from the workers a living labor which is exactly equal to the necessary labor. This is the beginning of the story. This is a hypothetical situation. This hypothetical situation is a crazy situation. There are no profits. Then Marx has a part in which again all the capitalist apologetical arguments comes into the story. The capitalists in space say, no, that's not impossible. I was abstaining from consumption, I was organizing the process. And Marx dismantles all these arguments and then says, but it was all a joke. The capitalist in Spain knew very well that he could extract more living labor than that necessary labor. So he lengthens the living labor beyond necessary labor. His method of comparison is based not on deducing from the wages the profits, but from a lengthening of the actual working. Maybe paradoxical for you, but the only author who saw this quite clearly, I saw this in a sense in 80 when I began studying. Then I went to look at these Raffa papers in the Raffa archives, and many surprises. The main one was there was a 40, 1940. He was a prisoner in the Isle of Wight, there was a war German. He was in Zion, he didn't know for how much, so he took with him two books. How much he was. So he put two big books, War and Peace, and Capital Volume 1, just retranslated. And he stopped in chapter 19, in a point which refers actually to my chapter 7, and he reads the method of comparison by Marx exactly in my way. The two sides of the comparison are real sites. One tells you what is necessary labor in real capitalism. And the other one, and this necessary labor, how it is determined? By the real substance wage, says Marx. Marx says the real substance wage, like the working day, chapter A, is constructed through class struggle. And you have wage, price, and profit. Huh? Then you have the second side of the comparison, and it is the result of class struggle in production. The extraction of living labor from the human bearers of labor power. And this is a specific situation, as I said yesterday. This is a situation in which capital has to force labor upon free and equal subjects. Here, not with the capital S, but with the moral S. This is Marx's explanation of the origin of surplus value, because it is Marx's explanation of the origin of all the new value which is produced. All the new value which is produced in this period must be exhibited in money and comes from what? From the living labor of workers. Marx says, in the first section actually of that chapter, that from the point of view of the capitalist, capitalist production is what? Consumption of the workers. This is a point, actually, a strong point of contact with my friend Massimiliano Tumba. Here, exploitation means use of labor power. Consumption of the living bearers of labor power. It is all the new value produced by living labor. This is the first meaning of exploitation, the qualitative determination of the working day. The distributive notion of exploitation, which is dear to the neo-Ricardians, surplus product on one side, the wage goods on the other side, or the distributive notion of exploitation, which is dear to the Marxist, the pure Marxist, surplus labor versus necessary labor, they are important, but they are derived, as it is derived, surplus money over the money wage pay. They are just a second notion, derived notion of exploitation, coming out from the fundamental notion of the conflictual and never taken to be granted use of labor power. I stop here for more or less 15 minutes. Before moving on, a few things on the point where we arrived. If I move from the level of the interpretation to the level of the reconstruction, the meaning I gave to this word at the beginning, I would say that this argument in chapter 7, which Marx puts forward as if it is related to the individual capitalist and the individual worker, should be rather rewritten in a macro setting, having the capitalist class as a whole on one side and the working class as a whole on the other side. It's actually something that Marx does in the same book 1 of Capital, in the section on reproduction, almost at the end of the book, and then we come back to that later on. The second thing that I would like to say is how what I am saying is related to the interpretation of Marx proposed by the so-called new interpretation. That is the interpretation of Marx by Duncan Foley, Gerard Menil, and Simon Moore. Duncan Foley, a famous economist from the US. Gerard Neil is a famous economist from France. Simon Mohn is a famous economist from England. Actually, what I am doing is to ground what Foley and Mohn especially call the assumption of the equality between the money value added on one side and the living labor on the other side multiplied for the monetary expression of labor time. We are on the same ground in that all of us are saying that the key for Marxian value theory is the fact that all the new value which is exhibited in money is originated by living labor. However, they took this as something which the theory assumed. The expression by Duncan Foley is that it is a postulate. I ground the postulate in Marx volume 1, I ground the postulate in the second paragraph of chapter 7, and for me this is not just something essential. It is the ground of the labor theory of value. Second, in fact, what is the money value added? They say it is the national income as long as it is produced by productive workers. And that's more or less okay. On the right-hand side, I think we should start calling what we see as direct labor, as not, and not as living labor. My argument is that in volume one, labor as activity and living labor is labor as activity. And when Marx writes in the first volume, Arbeit, he is meaning labor as activity, that labor as activity in volume one is always variable. I will come back on this point later on. It is not fixed. It is the activity of the worker, which then is objectified in the direct labor or present labor. But the direct labor is already that labor. It is the labor, living labor, which has become that. The third thing on which I should be much more detailed, but I've got the time, is to say that this direct labor has to be measured not with the clock, but it is the socially necessary labor time. This opens a hot series of problems. Because how do you understand socially necessary here? There is a technical definition, the labor which is contained in commodities according to the technical average. And then we should ask how this technical average is constructed. But we have a second meaning of socially necessary. And the second meaning is already from the last phrases of chapter 1 in volume 1. The commodities as long as it has value and the use value. But the use value must be use value for others. If the commodity is not use value for others, you have a product, you have not a commodity. So when you are speaking of socially necessary labor time, you are speaking of the labor time which has been expended according to some social need. So there is a second definition. In the second definition, The man, so to speaking, is driving production. You don't see this for most of capital because this, which is very clear in the first chapter, is sterilized after chapter 3. After chapter 3, Marx is assuming, but it is just an assumption at that point, that all that is produced is sold. But he has explained in the first three chapters that there is no reason for that. That says law is a stupidity. So the problem comes back again in volume three. I don't want to go into the details now. The last point is that in this identity of the new value, the money value added, with direct labor, what you have on the left and what you have on the right are non-homogeneous. What you have on the left are monetary magnitudes. What you have on the right are labor hours. It's not working. So, what rightly the new interpretation of Marx is saying, but a guy with whom I was working at the time in Turin said this in 79 already, before the new interpretation, the name is Marcello Messori. He left Marx actually after 84, 85. But he was one of the most exciting authors in Marxian theory. There is a translation of something in England, but in English it is a very bad translation. And I'm sure I'm right because most of what he said there is what I'm saying here now. Also, of course, I cannot but agree with him. We are accustomed to think together at the time. You have money magnitudes on one side, you have labor quantities on the other. To make them homogeneous, on the right hand side, it is put what the new interpretation calls and new Marxist approaches call the monetary expression of labor time. It's not difficult to understand. The monetary expression of labor time is monetary value added at the numerator divided the living labor, the direct labor. What you have, how much money in the national income you have produced with 1 hour of labor according to socially necessary labor time. It is, if you wish, the productivity of living labor in money terms. If you invert the monetary expression of labor time, what you have? The direct labor contained in the money value added at the numerator, so they are hours, and in the denominators, you have the money value added, so a monetary money. So you are saying how much money value added, the money quantity, how much, no matter is living labor, direct labor, how much labor in the numerator corresponds to 1 unit of money in the denominator. This is what the new interpretation calls the value of money, the direct labor over 1 unit of. Let's move on. And so we move from chapters 7 to chapter 8, but I already told you something about chapter 8. It is very important. It is the chapter on the legal determination of the working day. There Marx says that workers have their rights, so to speak, and capital has its right. And none of them is better than the other. There is a social conflict. conflict and the social conflict, and determining the legal length of the total working day. Chapter 9, if I remember, is about formulas relative to the other magnitudes. I now concentrate on chapters 10 to 12. In this chapter, what Marx is first doing is speaking of the extraction of absolute surplus value and the extraction of relative surplus value. You have the extraction of absolute surplus value if you assume that the real wage of the workers is given, but also the techniques are given. So what is given is actually the labor contained in the value of labor power. So what is given is the necessary labor. Let us say a working day for all Marx here of 12 hours, necessary labor is 6 hours. I want to raise surplus value in this situation, I have to lengthen in an absolute way the working day from 12 to 15, so to speak. So you have a rise in the ratio of surplus value over the value of labor power. Of course, this is related to the legal definition of the working day, because the legal definition of the working day stops this easy, too easy way for capital to gain surplus value, which amounts in the end in the holocaust of the working class, of course. So Rosa Luxemburg said trade unions actually are realizing the labor theory of value because they impose to capital to go in a different direction. The extraction of relative surplus value. The extraction of relative surplus value comes from higher intensity of labor. In the same hours, more labor is made liquid from labor power that is from the workers. 1 hour of labor with double effort, with double intensity, is like 2 hours of labor at the old intensity. If the real wage does not change, you produce in 3 hours what you produce in 6 hours if you had a doubling of the intensity of labor. So even if the length of the working day is given, now you have an increase of surplus value, which is relative, because necessary labor goes down. But of course, there can be also the change of techniques through innovation and technological change. In this case, what you have is an increase in the productive power of labor, Arbeit productive Kraft. You produce in the same time, because of the new means of production, more use values. Let us make it simpler. Here again, we have a doubling of the productive power of labor. So the example may be the same as before. 6 hours of necessary labor reduced to 3 hours of necessary labor. Usually, this is also an error of the workerist, operaist, operaismo literature. There is the idea that the absolute surplus value was, in the past, what is called the forward assumption of equal to value, forward assumption of labor to capital, and that then we had entered the age of the real assumption of labor to capital. I don't think it is so. The formal assumption of labor to capital does not refer only to the originary bloody capitalism. This formal means also and mainly that labor is put under the wage form or in an hybrid form under the command of capital. This is a point, if I remember well, which is done by one of the best authors on Marx of the younger generation, Trump I. Ack, who worked with Pierre Salamine, as Darwin book, relire Le Capital into volumes. And real consumption of labor capital, this is a point which was made in Italy by a friend of mine, Maria Turchetto, in the 70s. We do not agree on anything, on everything, but on this, I think she has a point. She says, look, the extraction of relative surplus value is something which starts from a given technological state. So the leaps in the real subsumption of labor to capital each time starts anew. What should be avoided is to think that absolute surplus value has nothing to do with today. The pension reforms of the age of when going to retirement are absolute surplus value. The intensity of labor shows that the labor made liquid by capital is variable, also if the length of the working day is legally fixed. The productive power of labor must not be confused. Here Marx employs but for year end in his use of the word with just the productivity of labor. Sometimes he uses productive debt, sometimes he uses productive craft. In an effort to be more Marx than Marx, I would say that productivity is producing more value, so to speak, by the workers, but this in the day, for example, either because the length of the working days goes up, or even because there is a higher intensity. So you could have a higher productivity even with the same productive power. This is a suggestion I use. Another thing which must be avoided is to think that absolute surplus value and relative surplus value are alternative. No, when capital introduces a new machines, they do this very often as a means also to increase the intensity of workers. This is very difficult to put it operationally because, of course, 1 hour with one intensity is completely different thing from 1 hour with another intensity. But qualitatively, you understand what I mean. And usually, when they have a new machine or the introduction of the extraction of relative surplus value, capital tries to exploit as much as it can this new machine. And so, if it can lengthen the working day one way or another. And you find this in Capital 101 very much detailed. So, for me, absolute surplus value goes together with relative surplus value, intensity of labor, and more higher productive power of labor goes together. I don't buy the sequence Taylorism, Fordism, which is in the book by Benjamin Coria, and it is also in most of the operative literature. It is also in a way in the writings of Maria Turchetto. You begins dismantling the work of a single worker, make it more mechanical, thanks, for example, to the Taylorism organizational technique. Then you make human work mechanical, and then you substitute the mechanical shape of human work with a machine, properly speaking. This is the theory of Adam Smith in the division of labor. It is not Marx. In my view, for Marx, the change begins essentially, logically, from the means of production. And so I am tempted to say that Fordism is before Taylorism. The movable assembly line is what made Taylorism effective. If we would go into some historical section of this argument, I would say that when tailoring was introduced in the United States, it was a failure. Higher intensity with the same technique, it makes transparent exploitation. It created workers' unrest. From the so-called operai di mestiere, skilled workers of the time. It won because there was the war, a kind of social emergency. And tailoring was one among many organizational innovations. When Ford introduced the new techniques, through the technological innovation, appears as something scientific. It is progress. The higher intensity is not just because the boss imposes that to you, and only that. It is because it is the machine that gives you the time. It is important to understand a consequence for the wage. I have a different interpretation of the theory of the wage from Bourgeois Capital than most of Marx's interpreters today. Here, the point that I want to stress is that Marx has no theory of the absolute miserization of the working class. Because, if imagine what I said, six hours, necessary labor, surplus labor, express, monetary, etc. Let us imagine that you have higher productivity of labor, together or not with higher intensity. So you have a reduction of necessary labor to 3 hours. Well, you can have an increase of the real wage. It may cost 1 hour more, you know, but now you can have a real wage which is higher than the real wage with the old technique, which was 6 hours. You can even reduce the working day. I'm not saying that capital does that without conflict. I am saying that there is this space in some occasions on the use value dimension, the wage working time, of a reformist compromise. There is not the space if you look at the value dimension. In the value dimension, what capital gains is lost by workers. I mean, and this is Rosa Luxemburg on the wage in her book, The Introduction to Political Economy, she said, she didn't like the foreign wage of property, but she said, there is a law in capitalism, and it is the law of the tendential fall of the relative wage. What is the relative wage? You don't find relative wage in Capital Volume 1, but you find it in Lavoro Salariato e Capitale, wage, labor, and capital. And that relative wage, which is a Ricardian category actually, can be seen as the wage, value of labor power, relatively to the gross profits, relatively to the surplus value. Or you can look at the value of labor power relatively to all the new value. It is clear that the relative surplus value extraction is reducing the share of the working day which is going to workers. If there is a higher real wage, if there is a reduction in the working day, the reduction in the share of the new value going to workers will be less than it would happen with the same real wage, with the same working day. But the point of Marx is that there can't be a situation in which all the gains of the productive power of labor are going to workers. So the relative wage must fall. Some said, oh well, but secularly, until the 60s and 70s when I was studying. The wage grew more or less like productivity. I am saying you are not considering the productive unproductive labor distinction. Part of the wage which grew like the productivity of labor was going to unproductive workers. Here we are in chapter 12. Chapter 12 is another of my preferred chapters, together with chapter 7. Chapter 12 is the chapter in which Marx tries to answer this question. Well, I told you the extraction of surplus value. I told you about the extraction of relative surplus value. But how these results are obtained, in fact? It is very easy to understand how the extraction of absolute surplus value goes on, because it is in the interest of the individual capitalist to lengthen absolutely the working day, because he gets more surplus value, he gets more gross profits. It's not so with relative surplus value, because relative surplus value, how it is accomplished, there is, to go easy, I go with the increase in the productive power of labor. There is a rise in the productive power of labor. There is a reduction of the prices of the wage goods of the workers. So the value of labor power goes down, and surplus value, relatively, goes up. Good, but this is a macro result. No individual capitalist understand that. So Marx realized that one point about the original distinction between capital in general and many capitals has to be revised. When Marx divided the logic of capital in the first part about capital in general, all that is common to all capitals, and the many capitalists first, fighting one another, he said the second thing is competition. And I will talk about competition after having finished capital in general. But you find competition, capitalist competition, in volume 1, in chapter 12. What is competition? Marx first took the notion of competition from Ricardo, and the notion was, it was Smith, the tendency of the rate of profit to be equal among the different industries, branches of production, sectors, called IO. A similar, not identical, but a similar notion of competition you find in Barras. Even more in Marshall, so before and after Marx, you have this view of competition. And it is, of course, this view of competition which gives way to the difference between the simple prices proportional to the labor contained in commodities, and the production prices, the capitalist production prices embodying an equal rate of. But this competition will be treated in book 3. In book 1 you have, I told you, competition already in chapter 2. Which kind of competition is it? It is a completely different kind of competition. It is a competition within the industry, within the sector, of one capitalist firm against another capitalist firm. They produce, say, the same use value. One introduces an innovation, a new machine, he has an increase in the productive power of labor. deeper and maybe also increase the intensity. But that is part of the sector. The price of that use value is determined by what Marx here called, I think, the social value, and in the third volume is called the market value, maybe the opposite, which is not the value of the individual producer. It is the value according to the socially necessary labor time. But those who introduce the new machine as an individual labor time, which is lower than the socially necessary labor time. So he gets an extra surplus value. He can even reduce slightly the price of what he sells. So he stole the market to the other capitalists. So this competition is a cutthroat competition. It is a competition of firms fighting for extra surplus value, and you cannot stay out of this competition because you die if you do that. This is the micro mechanism grounding the macro result. So you have Marx in chapter 12 as a macro social foundation, but he has to introduce this competition to provide the micro individual behavior, the micro individual mechanism realizing that. And it was completely new, because Grossman says in an important essay, I think, of the 30s. He was the first one to introduce this. It was a break. He is not alone in the history of economic thought. There was another author who had the same idea of competition, but he absolutely knew that he was indebted to Marx. And his other author is Joseph Alois Schumpeter. When he introduced the Japanese edition in the 30s of the theory of economic development, the Japanese economic culture was very learned in the history of economic thought. And he said, you know, those who read this book realize that my two heroes, are Léon Barras and Karl Marx. Why Léon Barras? Léon Barras, the logic of the circular flow. But the circular flow is Marx's capitalist reproduction with the zero rate of profit. It's something that Schumpeter himself said, this is not capitalism. It is a logical thing. The second author is Marx. Why? Because of this kind of competition. But for Marx, this kind of competition comes from class struggle production and inter-capitalist cutthroat competition. For Schumpeter, it comes from the vitalistic impulse of the Nietzschean leadership of the entrepreneurs. Chapter 13, 15, and beyond. There you go to cooperation, simple cooperation, the manufacturing division of labor, and machine factory. When you are at the stage of machines, there is fully the real subsumption of labor to capital. I talked about this yesterday, and I said that in this phase, technique and labor are determined by the social form. This is what is lost by the Neue Marxist Lecture. They stop, if it's okay, at chapter 4, a reading of chapter 7, which in my view is very limited, form determination enter into technique and labor in the actual capitalist labor process. For Marx, the zenith of the real subsumption of capital is machine factor. Then workers become technically the appendage of material conditioning. reflection. You don't find any more 1844 alienation in Marx. But you can read the alienation of 1844 backwards from capital. No, you know, workers have lost the possibility to control their work and the properties, Eigenschaften, concrete properties of their work. I say workers and not by chance. The single worker does not produce any more the commodity. The commodity is the product of a socialized worker. Here, Roberto Finelli is right when he says the individual worker is a worker whose labor is not anymore concrete, deconcretized. Yes, that's true. That was what happens in capitalism. What is wrong is the implication of Roberto Finelli that abstract labor in capitalism is cancelling completely the concrete labor. Capitalists have to sell use value to others, and use value to others must have concrete properties, so the labor producing it must have concrete properties. These concrete properties, however, are of the collective worker and comes to from the worker, in a sense, from workers to the workers, comes to the workers from outside, from a will and knowledge, which is capital's will and knowledge. And capital itself is promoting cooperation. So I don't buy the workers' argument that there is some kind of natural cooperation that capital steals. Capital is really producing what is staying, so to speak. I even would go so far as to say that we are in the phase of the real subsumption of labor to capital, rectum, wealth, the concrete wealth, is actually produced only by capital. Capital organized technique, organized the workers, their concrete properties, etc. Still, it needs to extract living labor from the workers. So, even though the use value productivity of capital comes from capital, the value productivity of capital can only come from workers. The labor theory of power. Here I agree with Chris Arthur. To do this, capital must incorporate workers. It is again an embodiment, but it's not the same embodiment as before. The German verb is different. Marx used the verb Einleiben. Capital must take human living labor power bearers and put them into this automatic, monstrous machine, which is actually capital itself. This is an intrusion into the body of capital. So that capital can produce and start working this machine as if it were by love possessed. For years I quoted this thing, it was wonderful. Then I asked myself, it comes from Goethe. Capital Volume 1 especially, because this finish is full of this kind of words. And it is in Faust, in Falstaff Tavern, I think it is, where there is a mice, un topo, mouse, which is poisoned. It starts to move practically as if it were by love possessed. It is moving from being living to being dead. This is the destiny of labor in this monstrous mechanism. What was the inspiration of this monstrous mechanism? Of course, Mary Shelley's Frankenstein. We can read Capital, and this is done by Mario Moretti in his essays also through Dracula. But unfortunately, Dracula was not written when Marx wrote Capital. But he would have said, and he said, even though he didn't refer to Dracula itself, that actually the chrysalis becomes a butterfly when the ghost of value becomes Capital as a vampire. It is an undead which can live only sucking living labor from the workers. You find a lot of translation of this, the verb absorbs living labor. No, in German it's sucking. Sucking living labor like a vampire, the other metaphor is werewolf. But I said it is, they are not metaphor. Here I am in the last 13 or 15 minutes, so I rapidly go to the last two things essentially that I wanted to say. Reproduction, section 7 on capitalist reproduction, and I will say also something about the wage there, and then what is not actually there in the first book of Capital, which is a discourse on crisis, except in the first three chapters. Okay, I will focus especially on chapter 25, the law of accumulation according to Marx, where Marx introduced the industrial reserve act. It has been interpreted in the economical literature, especially when I was studying, as a theory of the cycle, and even as a crisis theory. Capital grow with a given composition of capital, machines relatively to workers, expressed in value terms. It does not change this composition of capital. It invests always in the same proportions, in cost of capital and in variable capital, buying the same means of production and the same workers. At a certain point, the workers' reserve army is exhausted. Wages goes up. Capital creates innovation, introduce machines. To do this, it must increase the cost of capital relatively to variable capital. This may be seen, no, this creates what? The expulsion, at least the potential expulsion, of workers from the production process. So the industrial reserve army is like an army which extends and produces during the cycle. It may become a theory of the crisis, as it was interpreted in the late 60s, early 70s, from the authors who propose a theory of the crisis based on the profit squeeze. There are conditions in which workers' strength on the wage is increased so much that they squeeze profits. And then you have the crisis. Marx, the chapter was not meant as a theory of crisis, not even really as a theory of this cycle. It was the alternative that Marx provided to Malthus' law of accumulation. Capital has everything except labor power. And labor power is linked to living labor power. So it's linked to workers. But I show you that capital is able to posit its own presupposition because it is able to create an industrial army and to refurbish it. So what Marx is saying, something completely new again in economic theory, is that capital acts both on the demand of labor, the workers, the labor was the work that capital wants to buy, And the supply of labor, is the supply of the workers. But they are produced by capital itself, in a sense. They are produced by capital itself because they are, Marx used this expression, les dés sont pipés. The dice are loaded. The game is a tricky one. Of course, you can do like my first master in the critical political economy, Carlo Napoleoni. You can give a non-distributional view of the crisis of the late 60s, early 70s, and you can say that in Marx theory, because of this link of labor power, living labor to the workers, this dependence of supply of labor from the demand of labor in specific social situations may be reversed. If you reverse it, you may have a profit squeeze not really coming from the wage side. That may be relevant, but the most relevant thing is that this profit squeeze comes from the fact that workers may come into a situation in which they can control their labor effort. And this is what happened with the crisis of forced terrorism in the late 60s, early 70s. And for me, it was a key factor of the capitalist crisis in those years. I call it a social crisis, a crisis which is based on the dynamics of the immediate valorization process in production. Immediate means in production. Not mediated by. In that section of reproduction, more generally, I want to stress two things. One I already said, the other I have to go much deeper. The one that I already said is that in the chapter of reproduction, Marx frames explicitly its argument in a macroeconomic view. I am doing a mortal sin, probably, because macroeconomics, properly speaking, never existed before the 20s of the 20th century. It was invented by John Maynard Keynes. So when I'm talking of macroeconomic reasoning, I'm saying he is looking at the class relation of all of the capitalist class on one side and the whole of the working class on the other side. But this macro thing is so powerful that in fact we see in Marx a thing that we see also in Keynes, not only general theory but also the theories of Marx. The fact that the logic of the macro dimension is not only different, but it is opposite to the logic, which is the micro logic of the individual behavior. And at this point, I have to stop and go back to the old capital. What was doing Marx before this section? He started with money and commodity, then moved to capital. He analyzed capital and how capital is produced, as I told you, from the single worker versus the single capitalist, because the individual capitalist was taken to be an average representative of total capital. In that dimension, on the labor market, you have the phenomenal appearance, the phenomenal manifestation that workers and capitalists are free and equal subjects. And I use this. It is not false. It is something which is a bourgeois society, really, so to speak, especially if you look at it from the individual dimension. But But then Marx makes this step with the reproduction and move to the social, macro, total dimension. Marx is much more total, of course, than macro. And if you read it, he repeatedly says, before we said this way, now it is the opposite. The logic of the total is opposite of the logic of the individual. So much so that the relationship between capital as a whole and workers as a whole is a relation of slavery, the free and equal bargaining of the individual workers with capitalists is a shine, is a semblance. So what before was an erscheinung, a phenomenal manifestation, now changes, it becomes a semblance. When you read Marx, you must be very alert to all this. The meaning of the categories changes. Not that it by one is concerned, but changes. And here you have these big changes, which is a macro foundation of the individual behavior. The last thing on which I want to be equal is the wage. In fact, it is my idea that even though very cursorily, Marx in the chapters on reproduction is constructing an argument not far from what I called the monetary macroeconomics of the 20th century, the political economy of the 20th century, of Bixell, Schumpeter, Keynes, use of money, of the contemporary circuit theory of money. It is a French-Italian problem. I'm a part of it. The way I do the contemporary circuit theory of money, hopefully, is not political economy, but it is critical political economy. But still, there is the need of a critique. But Marx has a very similar setting, a macro setting in which capital advances as a whole, advances money to buy the labor power workers, and in this way, through this kind of checks, giving them a share of the total new living labor expended in the period, and to extract and retain the other part. It is a macro monetary theory of capitalist production and distribution of surplus value. And there are phrases, not in chapter 23, I think either 21 or 22, which says this quite explicitly, but you find a very similar thing in chapter 6 on publishing. There is one page and a half, and there even Marx is saying, look, that it is not workers that buy the means of subsistence, but there are the means of subsistence that buy the workers in this macro sector. Read the version, in this case, in the Lawrence and Wishart collected writings, because if you go to the Penguin translation of the chapter 6 unpublished, which is a good translation, there is a typo. I had a lot of discussions with my friends in the International Symposium of Marxian Theory. Then I took the German, and it was clear that it was in that way, because means of subsistence is translated as means of production. So the English Marxist reader looks at it and tries to make the thing work. It doesn't. It is English. Before going to the crisis, I am unfortunately a bit late, but it is important that I add one thing. Many times I spoke about the wage. Chapter 23, for example, is very important because it says the opposite of neo-Ricardian theories. It says that what is the independent variable? The rate of accumulation. What is the dependent variable? The wage. not so much the real wage. In my interpretation, it is the relative wage. But that is Marx's reason. I many times spoke of the wage, I many times spoke of the labor power. I assume that labor power is a commodity. There are two points in the recent literature and recent problematics in the past few days. First, is it really labor power a commodity? A lot of authors say no. Labor power is not produced like a produced commodity. The new interpretation stresses this, particularly Simon Mohn does this. I think that when Marx says that labor power is a commodity, he is not meaning labor power is produced like a produced commodity, but is using commodity in the generic meaning of something which is sold and bought. But the second point is, if you realize, everybody of us should have realized centuries ago, that workers are not produced like products, where are they produced? So to speak, in the household, we go towards the notion of social reproduction. Where is labor, domestic labor? Is domestic labor productive? Not productive of value, not productive of value. This does not mean that it's not important. But Marx is just saying that of what is the new value produced, capital has to give a part to the workers, the commodities they need to buy. Maybe he knew that there was a domestic labor. He didn't wrote the book on the wage labor, but certainly the point is crucial, because necessary labor is done by the paid part, which what Marx is looking upon, and on an unpaid part. And this unpaid part is crucial, and has been crucial in the history of capitalism, is crucial in the present crisis. It's what my partner, Giovanna Bertola, sometimes calls as a sort of private welfare system. Domestic labor is unproductive of labor. This doesn't mean that there should not be a distributive way of paying that. And say this is not productive of value and so good value. Domestic labor, however, is labor. In that labor, there is a dimension of care. And here we go on something very difficult. And what I'm saying, probably my partner will not agree 100% on what I'm saying. Somebody may think they're more feminist on this than she, but I strictly avoid, I'm not feminist. In the meaning of, I don't want to take the hat of a feminist. The point is that care is not something mystical. Care is true labor. There is a French-Canadian author, Tronto, who speaks of the labor of care. And this labor dimension. At the same time, it is a work very relational. We should not make a mistake of it. At the same time, it is a different paradigm of the work and labor that Marx had in mind when he wrote the first paragraph of chapter 7. In a sense, this is where I become utopian. In that kind of care labor, there is a hint of what would be socialism. From the first book of Capital, I have three hints of what would be socialism. A labor which is already immediately social in the act of work. A labor which is immediately socialized, a collective worker in the moment of work. The two things are divided in capitalism. Third, a dimension in which the interrelationship and also care dimension of labor and human relationship is maximized. Of course, this should go, Marx would say, with the reduction of the working day. So Marx says, yes, some liberation of labor, from labor, but he never goes towards a negative view of labor as such. He is not like Tolstoy, in which you go out of the dimension of labor. He is quite clear that labor must become the first need of the socialized. I will take no more than 8-9 minutes of crisis theory. Crisis theory, as I told you, is not in book one, except at the beginning. In the first three chapters, Marx is saying, when you have money already in simple situation, commodity, money to buy another commodity, the possibility of selling and not buying is already there. So the formal possibility of crisis is there. But then he stops. And he makes his assumption. The assumption that everything that is produced is so. At the end of volume 2, he writes its own peculiar tableau economique. The tableau economique was, according to Marx, the most brilliant idea of political economy. Such brilliant idea that was immediately forgotten. Smith and Ricardo didn't have it. He discovered it one century after. Of course, he had to change the tableau economique and he made the schemes of production. I assume that you know what the schemes of production are. He didn't build the schemes of production as a picture of capitalist actual accumulation or as a picture of balanced equilibrium growth. That was the way they were interpreted when I was studying. Absolutely not. Marx had before him, as I told before, Say and Ricardo, which said there is no possibility of general glut of commodities, general production of commodities. And there were Malthus and Sismondi who said with the distribution, with part of the income which goes to the profits, there are savings are not consumption, so the income produced is higher than consumption, there will be an immediately collapse. Capital is always in equilibrium for one view, never in equilibrium for the other view. Marx is saying no. Equilibrium is possible, but it is a chance. The schemes of production shows that capital creating supply creates its own demand. All the demand originates from capital, except, and this was already, of course, in the Grundrisse said, that the condition of the production of value are not the conditions of the realization of value. So, in theory, all the demand is there. Nobody says that it is proportioned to the structure of supply. So, the schemes of production has not much to do with the theory of crisis. They have to do with the possibility of crisis at an higher dimension, at a deeper dimension than in the first three chapters of Capital Volume 1. The theory of value becomes a theory of crisis with the falling rate of profit theory and with the realization crisis. Falling rate of profit theory in Volume 3, realization crisis in volume 3 and in the theories of solution. I agree with Michael and Heinrich that Marx probably has already abandoned the foreign rate profit view, already when he wrote the first book of Kant. At the same time, I think that beyond Marx, it is interesting to read the foreign rate profit theory as a meta theory of the crisis, as a crisis theory which includes in itself the other tendencies to the crisis, realization crisis, the social crisis, as I told you, from the struggles in immediate production process, considering that in time, and this seems to be the most Marxian proposition, the counter tendencies win over the tendencies. So I build, that's me, reconstruction, a stage theory of capitalism where the long depression of the end of 19th century can be interpreted according to the falling rate of profit in the usual way. The composition of capital goes up, and there is not enough surplus value, so it is a crisis of profitability, low profitability. But then there are the counter tendencies. And what were the counter tendencies mixed with the class struggle? The transformation of capitalism from fully competitive to trustified capitalism, and Fordism and Taylorism. All this controlled the increase of the value of capital, so the increase, the rise of the composition of capital, and with the devaluation of the prices of means of production and the prices of wage goods, they controlled again the composition of capital and pushed up the rate of surplus value. So the tendency of the rate of profit to fall was won in its simplest version, but creating the conditions, the winning that was creating the condition of the realization crisis of the 30s. The realization crisis of the 30s is a crisis not of underconsumption, but in my reading of underinvestment. I don't go into that in detail. It was overcome thanks to the destruction of capital because of World War II and because of the so-called Fordist era after World War II, that is Keynesianism in practice. But I think that Paul Martig was right when he said that in this Keynesian era, a larger share of the production was not production of capital, but production as such, production of use values. This means that the share of non-directly productive workers, I mean non-directly productive workers of surplus value, was increasing. Does this create immediately crisis? No. If you are able to push up and push up and push up the rate of surplus value over the productive section of the working class. For historical and social reasons, this was not anymore possible after the mid-60s, not the mid-70s. I have the crisis of 40s originated before the oil crisis. Struggles in the US, struggles in the Paris, Maine, struggles in Italy, generalized struggles in the immediate production process, wage struggles too, created a situation of, again, a big crisis of capital, a great crisis. The first great crisis, I told you, was a crisis of low profitability, the falling rate of profit in traditional ways. The second crisis was underinvestment crisis. That's not a crisis of low profitability immediately. It is a crisis of too much potential profitability before the crisis. But in the 60s and 70s, the reason of the crisis is again low profitability, but not mainly because the composition of capital went up, but because directly workers' struggles were controlling or even reducing, in some cases, Italy's 68-73, the surplus value relatively to the value of labor power. Rosa Luxemburg law was reversed. And if you read Rosa Luxemburg, she says when this happens, this is not anymore a struggle on the wage. This is a revolutionary struggle. So the third crisis, low profitability, and you understand it as a reaction to what happened before, overcoming the great crash of the 30s, and you understand the great crash of the 30s as a reaction to the first crisis. Neoliberalism, and it goes here, is exactly the way out from the crisis of the 70s through two legs: the deconstructing and casualization of labor on one hand, and the real subsumption of labor households to capitalist finance and debt. This created neoliberalism. Neoliberalism for me is this real subsumption of labor to finance, but it is also a very dynamic and political configuration of capitalism, which however was built on what? On increasing debt of households so that they could spend, and so the new driver of autonomous demand was not investment, was not net exports, and you have thought that do not have net exports anymore, whatever, was not government expenditure as such, it was consumer debt, consumer consumption based on debt. This was based on household going more and more into debt. This became an unsustainable position. So the fourth crisis is again a crisis because of too high profitability before the crisis. And it presents itself as a financial crisis immediately. But it is a financial crisis in a stronger meaning than before. Because these financial mechanisms were, yes, perverted, but were the way capitalists could accumulate before before the Great Recession, if you want to call it that. So, paradoxically, fictitious capital ended being a very non-fictitious reality because it forced households and families to work more time, to work more intensively, push it up the, in some areas, the productive power of labor and investments abroad, forced it through in capital asset inflation, it pushed up the wealth of households, mostly rich households, but not only there. So it pushed up the debt consumption. So neoliberalism was able to create inside itself the demand, the new form of demand. And it was a politically managed system. This could happen because of the new monetary policies and new forms of policies. So paradoxically, I call this reality as privatized Keynesianism. There is a sociologist who came to the same conclusion independently, and he is Colin Crouch. So you see the paradox. What I'm thinking is that capital never abandoned the state, economic policy, and all that. They change it forces. And there is always a management of effective demand, which is also a management of supply. And I close here. 10 minutes to wait.
Okay, thank you. Your lecture was very illuminating.
You mean
one Hegelian sense or something else? You stated critique of political economy is a critique of capital. Of course, it is connected with so-called exhibition, but first of all, with emancipatory perspective. What does it mean? Where is Maastricht in measure, criteria in this movement? Shortly speaking, logic is not critique of categories or of phenomenology. Yes, if we could treat categories, concepts as equivalent of forms of consciousness from phenomenology, it seems that capital is closer to phenomenology of political economy than to logic of essence, for example, as in Neue Marx lecture, for example. Two important questions.
I would collect the questions so I give only one answer at the end. Otherwise, there are no
if there are questions, are there questions? Because I would like to ask two questions. First is also connected with the idea, what is das Kapital in India? Perhaps it's not phenomenology, perhaps it's not logic, but it's an extension of a critical ideology. Perhaps the notions which are being critiqued in the capital are simply pure ideological notions. It's not pure,
not impure.
Okay. It is okay. The game of shine in a reality. And the second question, during the first section of the lecture, you suggested, in my opinion, that the whole meta-theory, which is presented in Capital, is connected very, very firmly with the concept of money, with the capitalist concept of money. If so, is my intention good that the Marxian theory of value, or Marxian concept of value, is valuable only in capitalist system of production? If so, there's no sense talking about Marxian idea of value, well, in connection with pre-capitalist societies or post-capitalist societies. Yes.
Okay, I answer merely the four big questions. First, two years. Phenomenology or logic, and what is this emancipatory process? On the first point, I have not completely settled my thinking 100%, and probably will never be, because I was very much influenced by this friend of mine, Roberto Finelli. We even wrote a paper signed together. He contributed only to the first paragraph, half of that paragraph, which was philosophical, the other half was mine. It is not that I wanted to be that way, but it ended that way because we finished the paper and it was there. It is relevant because he says, and this is half of me, for me, that the beginning of capital is phenomenological, but capital is logical. He says the method of capital is the positive or the presupposition of logic and the logical concept. But the beginning of capital is phenomenological. I begin from the commodity because it is the instance of wealth which is more diffused out there. It sounded convincing to me. At the same time, my schizophrenic me is always very much impressed by those who say Marx chose the commodity as the cell from which the logic of capital develops. Then you have two lines. Those who stress the logic of essence, my friend Tony Smith, my friend Gerhard Ruth, and etc., and those who stress the logic of concept. In both cases, this is a unity in my divided self.
And our idea of does capital as phenomenological.
Don't stop me, otherwise I am not a philosopher, I lose myself. But I think I arrived to answer you. What I am saying is that the both sides of my divided self thinks that the reference to the logic is to the logic of concept. And both myself thinks that there is an homology between capital and Geist because the reference is the logic of concept. So the only thing that I allow to the phenomenology of the spirit is just maybe the beginning.
And only infinitely.
At the beginning. Then, second step of the argument, however, and I told this yesterday referring to Schmidt, and today referring to Schmidt and Durkheimer, etc. I think that this is half of Marx. The homology is very strong, chapters 1 to 4. We are able, as my friend Roberto Fineschi does, to construct a literal story following the logic of capital related to the logic of the concept. It is reasonable. Marx didn't accomplish that. The homology is very strong, chapter 1, to my interpretation. 1, 2, 3, 4. After, there are ints in which he gives the references so that you can construct the Hegelian reading of the Marx logic. But in my view, this is half of the story because it is the story analyzing the system as finished form, analyzing the fetish. But this fetish has to be constituted. And the constitution is not just exchange and the private labors, it is also the constitution in the class struggle in the capitalist labor processes. This goes towards the second question of words. What is this emancipatory practice? Marx does never has a theory of theory, forgive me the repetition, as correspondence, as mirror of an outside reality. But he does not even as a theory of the truth as just linguistic, logical coherence. The logic of the concept is good at that level. But the knowledge, and this is the autocentric element in me, is always the knowledge through the object of knowledge, of the real knowledge there, and there is a practice which is before and after and maybe even in the middle of knowledge. So the critique of political economy of Marx would have never born if there would not have been a practical labor movement, even with Luddites, criticizing in practice the naturality of the machines. And as long as the living theorists of labor power act as cogs in the machines, even though the labor theory of value for me is scientifically true, it is also scientifically false, you know, because the reality out there is actually perfectly, one can very well understand it with even neoclassical theories. And this point, which is raised in a wonderful short article of the original release of the manifesto by Lucio Colletti, and it's translated in English, his last essay in From Rousseau to Lenin. And that really says there are two capitalism, and two logics. And the logic of the critique of political economy is this one, and it is linked to the fact that this exposition, scientifically for me, in the end words, if you relate to fetish to the human origin is capitalist class struggle in society and in production. Without that, Marx is not Marx. Maybe it is Hegel, I don't know. Maybe it is a fake Hegel put upside down. It would be a Marx that does not interest me. It would not interest me even the Marx purely saying, oh, we need to do struggle. The two dimensions must be together. And you can understand the class struggle, which is also the class struggle of capital against labor, if you don't reconstruct this fetish, how it works. I come to your questions. Yes, capital can be read theoretically, logically, also, as you say, ideologically. And in what I'm saying, I'm sure it can be translated ideologically. I am very much in love with this idea that here you have an Hegelian logic and an emancipatory practice. And in a non-Hegelian fashion, Leslie Kowakowski, in his essay on practical truth, maybe not in a completely convincing way, was again, as an essay on Marx and the notion of truth, going towards that dimension. There are a lot of papers in the 60s and in the 70s which were forced to take this into account. In a sense, sometimes, I don't know if I feel like an evangelist or just a completely crazy guy. Evangelist because I realized that what for me was the ABC was forgotten. So if I just go and repeat what I knew and was told me when I was young, it's useful. Maybe it is completely a crazy position because reality has changed. I can make an example. Alfred Schmidt remained a great philosopher, but one thing is what he wrote between 60 and 72, 73, 74, 75. Later on, it is the same person, very much readable, but mysticism, masonry, Schopenhauer, this, that, in great things, in which there is a lot that you can take. But what is the relationship between these two guys? And I think there is a story about Colletti, about my master Napoleonian, and I can go on and on. Your first question was also
about theory of Marx as a theory of money value, and presence of theory in a connection with pre or post capitalist society?
There are two questions. The first question is, yes, I stress very much money. My game is to say it's not production on one side and circulation on the other. production real, circulation one. There is the capital relation and then the exchange relation among capitals. The capital relation is capital and workers, but it is dual. It's not just immediate production. It is buying and selling of power and immediate production. So the capital relation must already be monetary, and it is monetary. But the money which is relevant for the buying and selling of labor power is not categorically the same money as the universal equivalent. It is money as finance to production. And the game of me and the people like me is to deflate the Marxist obsession with money as universal equivalent, which is important. I don't go towards cancelling it, and shifting a lot the attention to the capital money in the capital relation and saying that capital relation must be analyzed beginning from a macro logic and then go towards the micro relations among the capital. I open a parenthesis because I didn't say that, but it's important. If the ground of the labor theory of value is that you can argue that all the new value, all the money value added, is nothing but the living labor objectifying and exhibited in money terms, who cares about the transformation? Let us imagine that Marx did the calculations wrong. The individual prices are accountable in a different way than Marx. They are just individual prices that cannot but redistribute a given amount of the new value coming from the new. That's value theory for me. Post-capitalism, I can say very little on post-capitalism.
Well, let's have a
pre-capitalism.
Yeah. This is theory of value.
Yes.
You got not money.
On that, yes. Now remember what I said when you said that. That's perfect. I completely agree that value theory, money theory, as Marx used that, is only a theory of capitalism. I would even go as far as to say that value theory is the theory of exploitation, but then, because Marx has a theory of exploitation with value only. But Marx said exploitation in capitalism existed before, because before it existed necessary labor and surplus labor, as in capitalism. There Marx is below himself. It is not rigorous, because his theory of exploitation in capitalism is a theory of exploitation, a situation in which labor is not anymore, as in Adam Smith, the active factor. Instead, they are the machines, it is capital that organizes, etc. The point of that theory of exploitation is that you can argue that behind the new value, there is just living labor, so behind the surplus value, there is surplus labor. But to do this, you have to reduce the commodities to value through money. This can be done rigorously only in capitalism. Marx of labor is only capitalism. So was Marx completely crazy when he said that in feudalism and in slave society there was an exploitation of workers? No, because in the loose meaning, but in a meaningful meaning, that can be argued. Capitalism is the arena of capitalism. Is a very dynamic formation or mode of production before stationary society. Changes were very little. Techniques increased not as rapidly as in capitalism. So this median view that you have an active factor of production, labor, and the rest is inactive, which is the view that for me, most Marxists have, effort must be more. Rosa Luxemburg, the chapter of the wage, she says the specificity of capitalism is that before capitalism, what was defined in real terms was what will go to the dominant class. So if workers work more, they could get more if by chance they can do that. In capitalism, it is the opposite. What is given is what it is going to the workers. So the more I can extract living labor, the more I get surplus pay. The logic for me is the following. Exploitation before is an analogy which simply says that in a stationary society, you produce more if you work more, or you are something, somebody that work more for you. Huh? In capital, it is a completely different world.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I stay
up so many back is
lecture.
Okay.
So, if not, thank you very much.
Thanks for your
attention
and patience.